Best. Who used to turn on your show? It's kind of embarrassing, actually.
You've been working with Mr. Ed now for 5 years. Do you know
him? Yes. You know something?
No. What's
that? I'd like you to meet Raymond Bailey. He plays.
I've seen that movie where 007 is fighting his arch enemy on top of the Golden Gate Bridge. Those of us who grew up in the San Francisco Bay Area knew just a couple of places. One was Gurneyville, as we used to say in those days, at the Russian River, Lake Tahoe sometimes if you were wealthy, and also Hoberg's. Hoberg's Resort was a place that was the exotic place you used to go to for dances and to meet friends, and well, it's a pleasure now to meet Beverly Hoberg, whose family started Hoberg's in what year?
Oh, long time ago. I don't know the years.
We'll just say a long time ago. We'll say a long, long time ago. So this was a family business though, right?
Yes, it started out just as a place for hunters to go after they bought the property. My relatives came from Germany, so. And they decided, the hunters loved grandma's cooking. So they'd said to them, please, can we bring our family up? It's beautiful country. And so they put up tents for them.
So the original was tents.
Was
right?
Tents. And then people started coming and they built cabins and put a big kitchen in, and they were off.
It just sort of grew by itself like that.
That's right. Exactly that way.
Yeah.
So.
And that was in the 20s? When was it?
Yeah. It could have been even a little bit earlier than the 20s. Yes. Yes. Long time ago. But
And it was sort of like unexpectedly, the family found itself in the resort business.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. Because the location was among the pines. That was their slogan, Hoberg's Among the Pines.
Yeah. And what do you remember about being a young person there? I mean, what did you have duties of some sort? You had uncles who were there and people telling Beverly, this is what you're supposed to do?
Well, Grandma and Grandpa Hoberg had the resort, and then they gave it, I think for money too, to the three boys, which was George, the oldest, my father, Paul, and then Frank, the youngest. So the three owned the resort.
And did they ever get into conflicts about what they were doing, or they just got along like a wonderful Hoberg family?
No, there was conflicts because my father was the chef. And he was the worker. And he was
in charge, I'll bet.
No, George was in charge more, but my father did a lot of the work that was needed.
Yeah, well, growing up with three boys like that, someone's got to be in charge, right?
Yes.
When you think back on it now, quite a few years later, what sort of stands out in your mind about those years?
Well, we were very lucky as children because we lived in the country. We could go swimming. We had a swimming pool.
Right.
I was very athletic because I knew how to play ping pong. I knew how to shuffleboard. I knew how to tennis. Everything that came up was on the resort to do. So it was a wonderful place. And children that came up to stay for 2 weeks or so forth, they thought that we were really the best we could possibly be because we didn't have to leave the resort every summer.
Right.
We could just stay there.
Sure. That was your home.
That's right. We did have a home.
Did you realize at that time what a different kind of upbringing you were getting?
Just
seemed like this is what everyone does, right?
That's right. That's right. We didn't realize it until some of these kids told us that, you know, and we kind of smile and say, ha ha, you have to go home, you know.
Wait a minute. You mean the fact that you made fun of the guests? Is that what you're telling me?
Because they were our friends.
So. I see. Yeah. Okay. And they stayed that way, right?
Yeah.
Right. They must have been very envious of you.
Very, very envious.
I can totally understand that.
Yeah.
When you were there and living in that area, what was your favorite thing to do? Well, you mentioned some of the activities you did, but...
Well, I was always fond of my bike as a different mode of transportation. And I really never walked around the resort. I rode my bike all over. And we could, well, if, for example, we had trails to ride bikes on. And, you know, there was always something to do.
You mean you went right to a bicycle, two wheels, and not a tricycle like I did?
I had a little tricycle with a sidecar. And I had put my dolls in that and things like that, or my little brother. So that was first, and then I got my bike.
Now listen, how did you get along with your family, your brothers?
Wonderful.
Yeah. I mean, was that just a good time was had by all? Was the same goes?
Well, my sister was very smart, and she was the reader, so she was constantly reading all the time.
Uh-huh.
But my little brother and I were more close because he could do things that I could do, or I tell him what to do, you know. So.
Yeah.
And we had a lot of fun. Yeah.
Yeah. And looking back on it now, was there anything you would change about that time?
No, nothing.
I didn't think so.
Nothing. No.
Yeah.
Because even in the winter time, we had good times because my father was home then. And we had a regular house, and we had a big playroom, we called it, upstairs. And if it rained, we loved the rain because we could gather with my cousins and my family, and we'd play games. It was before TV.
I was about to ask you, because it does get rain up there.
Yes.
And I was about to ask you about that, about when it did rain and you were living there.
Yes.
You were in the redwood trees and the rest of it.
No, not the redwoods. No. Just the pine trees.
Just the pine trees.
Yeah, redwoods are not along the coast. Yeah.
Yeah. So you lived up there and you always had something to do, even when it rained for 2 weeks at a time or whatever.
That's right. And of course, we had to go to school. And
that's the other thing I was going to go to. Yeah. Now, where did you go?
I went to Cobb Valley, which was lower in the valley,
right.
And we had to be driven every day to school, and somebody picked us up every day.
Uh-huh.
It's a one-room school with one teacher and eight grades, and there was only one boy and I in the eighth grade when I graduated out of that school.
You know, you and I are about the same age, but I never grew up in a one-room schoolhouse. Grew up in San Francisco when you had a regular classroom with people.
Right.
It's hard for me, and I think for other people, to imagine what it's really like to grow up in a one-room schoolhouse. It's something out of a novel or something of that nature.
Maybe. I don't know. It just was part of me, you know. And the teacher was wonderful, Mrs. Egan. I had her for 8 years, and she lived up. She had a little resort called Whispering Pines.
Oh.
And
wait, the teacher also had a small
resort? Yes.
Hey, doesn't everybody?
No, not everybody, but yeah. So it was a wonderful school because my father had gone to the same school, and he only went 8 grades, and then that was the end of his schooling. He had to work on the resort.
So you had to be driven.
Yes.
Was this somebody in the family drove you?
Yes. There were, of course, the three families,
right.
And everybody took a week and drove. And even one time we took our bikes and went to school. But then it was fine going down the hill, but it was terrible going up.
Yes, I don't doubt that.
Yeah, so, but that was, you know, we decided that was fun.
Yeah.
And even one time my father decided, because he had gone to that school, that we should walk the trail that he walked, which was down a mountainside. And we said, oh, sure, we'd love to do that. So we decided one morning to Monday maybe, go to school that way. The only problem we had was they had built this farmhouse and they had a bull in the field, and we had to cross, and the bull chased us across the field, and my brother just made it under the fence. He was little at that time.
Do you know, Beverly, that you're the first person I've ever talked to who was going to school who had to worry about being chased by a bull?
I know.
I mean, really.
Well,
what kind of an experience is that?
I don't know. It was one I never will forget because it was the scariest thing that's ever happened to me.
Well, of course.
And we never went down that trail again.
You know, I grew up in next to Golden Gate Park. We never had a bull chase us.
No, never. Maybe a buffalo.
A buffalo, right. Yes. I remember the buffalo at Golden Gate Park.
That's right. Yeah.
That's right. Now, when you lived up there, did you ever come down to the city?
Because my mother's mother and father lived on Frederick Street.
Oh, yeah.
In San Francisco. Uh-huh. And we came down, I think, a lot of holidays, but we had always Christmas, I think, at our own home in the country. And my father was the type that he was in charge of Christmas, and we didn't have a tree up until he would go out and climb a huge tree and take the top out. And
did he do it in Golden Gate Park?
No, where did he do that? No, he did it up there, and there was plenty of trees up there.
Yeah, yes, there are.
And we had the Douglas fir tree, see. And he would put up the tree, put on all the lights and the decorations. And we weren't allowed into the front room until it was Christmas Eve.
You know, isn't it interesting to have a tradition like that, where dad goes out, or father, as we'd call him probably, and cuts down the tree and brings it back? I mean, how many families have memories like that?
They don't. It's really unusual,
Yeah, it's an amazing thing. Yeah. And the relationship you had with your parents?
Wonderful. My mother was the bookkeeper, and of course my father was the chef. But as I said before, I looked forward to the fall. It was my favorite time of year because mother and father were back in the house again. And I did a lot of things with my dad because I wasn't scared of the dark. And he'd say, I hear the dogs barking, Bev. Or Beverly, I think he called me. Would you like to go and see what's going on? Yeah. So I'd put on my boots and off we'd go. And sure enough, the dogs would treat a raccoon or something. And then he didn't like raccoons, so he shot the raccoon.
I see. And this is how you grew up.
That's right. So yeah. I was, used to hunting, used to eating deer meat, which was good.
And right. Venison.
Delicious.
Yeah.
And used to, his hunting habits, like pheasant and things like that. My mom was a good cook.
I used to go pheasant hunting with my dad and my uncles and the rest of it. But there's something about having daughters of my own, about a father and daughter relationship.
Right.
That's special.
Right.
Right?
I agree.
And you obviously, from what you're telling me now, you had that kind of relationship.
I did. Yes, I did. He was a very quiet man, but yet, if you got him mad.
Don't get him mad.
That's right.
Don't get him mad.
But he used to be in the summer was always get the food ready and have the help ready and all this stuff. But in the winter, he did a lot of carpentry, fixing up the cabins, or sometimes, pipes would burst and things like that. He was always the one that did it. So he was, very talented man.
You know, I grew up in San Francisco. But my father ran a summer resort at a place called Bucks Lake, up in Plumas County. And he used, my dad used to do the same thing. We had cabins, had a bar.
Yeah.
The people who drank too much sometimes. Yeah. We had all those things going on. So I can empathize with the kind of stuff you had when you were growing up.
Right.
When you look back on it now, what memories do you have that are the most important?
I think one of my favorite memories is just riding my bike around the resort. And I always thought that I was, I had a voice that was like Judy Garland.
I see.
So, you know, I thought.
You were singing?
Yes, I was singing on my bike. And yeah, I
Beverly,
sing.
That's a scary thought. I'm sure you were a good singer.
Oh, well, it was fun, you know, and I remember doing that. And, you know, or riding my bike and having everybody chase me because I knew the two trees that I could have my handlebars get through. And nobody else, they all had wider handlebars. They couldn't follow me through those two trees.
Well, that's the kind of childhood you can't replace in any way.
No.
It's the kind of memory that today,
yes,
you know, 2015, you still carry
those
still memories.
And I want to, you know, keep those in my mind.
I have a question for you. Being a person very close to the same age that we are, do you have better memories of 30 or 40, 50, 60 years ago than you do yesterday?
Well, I'm very fortunate because when I was 13, I started a diary.
Really?
And I still keep my diary. I have, I don't know how many. They're 5-year diaries. And right at the moment I'm reading my diary, that when I first started school and things like that. I did it 13.
When you first started in school?
13 to high school.
Wow.
So I'm reading that. It's very interesting. Because you forget a lot of things, you know.
Do you look at that and say, that was me?
No, I remember when that it was me that was doing this, you know. So it's.
And do you do that to this day?
Yes. Every night I write my diary. Yes.
What a wonderful idea.
I know.
What a wonderful gift for the family.
Well, my sister was very, very organized, okay? And she said to me one day, Bev, you've got to keep a diary. I'm keeping mine and you keep yours. So I didn't really care about keeping a diary, but I did it. And then when we had children, both of us, it was even harder to keep a diary. So one day I called her up and I said, Jane, what did you do yesterday? I can't remember. And she said to me over the phone, she said, oh, Bev, didn't I tell you that? I gave that up 2 years ago. I almost killed her. Because here I was struggling with my diary and she had given it up. And I never forgave her.
Well, you know what? To wrap this up.
Yeah.
You still look great.
Yeah.
And you're still full of spirit and fun and memories. And I think that's a wonderful, wonderful thing.
Thank you.
It's been my pleasure to talk to you.
It's been mine too.